This is the Focus Group with Business Insiders Tim Bennett and John Nash.
I fought worse monsters than you for years in Hollywood. I know how to win the hard way.
We're all business, except when we're not.
Don't f*** with me, fellas! This ain't my first time at the rodeo.
Oh, John loves that clip. You really love that clip, don't you? Hey, this is the Focus Group. I'm Tim Bennett here, as always, with my good friend and co-host, John Nash. And we're all business, except when we're not.
Except when we're not.
So, and the great thing about us now is you can find us everywhere. So we say that we're back, for those of you who are fans of the Focus Group. But now we're bigger and better than ever. We like to say you can find us on iTunes. Mm-hmm. Go to our Facebook page, which is Focus Group Radio. You can find us at TuneIn. You can find us at YouTube, which gives us this visual aspect that we didn't have before, and SoundCloud. Am I missing something? John worked diligently to try to get us on all these platforms in the last.
Yeah, they know there's a whole bunch of whole bunch of platforms. Basically, wherever good podcasts are sold or traded,
you'll be able to find us. So be sure to follow along with subscribe, like us, and join the Focus Group family. We also have a phone number, which is 914-362-8747, which is 914-FOCUS-GR. And there's a new segment we have at the end of each show, which is Ask Tim and John. So any questions that you have for us, you can call there and leave your message, and you'll get a chance to win a pair of our famous socks if we use your question on it.
Yeah, it's one of the few ways we've discovered or are thinking about distributing the socks, because they're so very popular.
And everybody loves the socks. So who do we have on the show today, John?
Well, we have a very good friend of ours coming on after we are doing our normal day in history and what caught our eye, and that's Scott Seitz, who's the CEO and founder of SPI Marketing, also the founder of a very cool organization called Dot Gay, which he's going to talk a little tiny bit about, but that's going to be more instrumental later on down the road. But today we're going to be talking to him about LGBT marketing, advertising, and why of that is because the June is around the corner.
Right.
And, you know, I think with Gay Pride Month coming, that's a month that has changed so much over the last several years. Well, think about it.
Does it matter anymore?
All those questions, we will wait.
I think it does. But everybody talks about the grinder effect, and we'll talk to him about that. Has that really hurt the marketing to the gay consumer? Which, what do you always say, John? There's no gay marketing.
That's one of my favorite lines that you like. It's there is no gay market. There's only about, 14 to 17 million?
I'll say 20.
20 million gay and lesbian, don't say, right? LGBT consumers.
They won't identify.
And they're all different. They all consume like everybody else does. But I think what ties everybody together in that, if you look at that silo, is LGBT.
Yep. Before we head off to talk about some of our caught my eyes this week and some of our other banter, we just want to remind everybody that John and I will be taking a trip in June. It's going to be June 17th, which is Friday, through June 19th for a Gay Wine Weekend, which is brought to you by OutInTheVineyard.com. And so if you'd like to join us, be sure to go to OutInTheVineyard.com and sign up for Gay Wine Weekend. I think it sells out pretty quick.
It does. We had the two guys that run it, Mark and Gary, on last year when we were out in L.A. And after they left the studio, you and I, and I've said this before, I think I said it the last time we were on, gee, that sounds like a lot of fun. Somehow that got relayed to them, and now we're going to experience the fun.
So here's the deal. I got the itinerary. I've been trying to get, and we'll have to speak about it with them. But I got the itinerary, and there's two options. And I actually initially thought that you and I would split up. So
I'm going to experience a couple vineyards.
So there'd be wine tasting, and then there's wine dinners. And then I thought, as I looked at it, I said, you know what? You and I do our best work together. When I thought about that drive we did cross country with Volkswagen, about how much fun we had when we went to Merrimack Caverns and some of those other places, I thought it would be, I think, for the show, because when we come back to recap, kind of the funny antics that you and I would have at the dinners or the tastings together versus us being on our own. So, but you have to make that decision. Right now.
And part of that is when we compare notes.
Yeah.
Behind the scenes, like, what'd you think of that? What'd you think of that? Yeah.
So I do think it's going to be a great trip. And initially when we talked, we were going to split up. But as I read the itinerary, I just think maybe you and I should do it together. But we'll see. So again, be sure to check out. Yep. OutInTheVineyard.com.
All right, so here we go. A couple of crazy weeks, and what caught your eye this week?
Can I tell you something before I caught my eye? I had the strangest thing happen to me this morning. And I don't know if it's ever, have you ever, there's a lot of thing about sensory perception, I guess, or you'll smell something and it might remind you of something when you were younger. So I woke up this morning at 3. I looked over at the clock from what I could see with my blurry eyes, and it looked like it was 3 o'clock-ish. And the strongest odor of a pipe, tobacco pipe, like a cherry wood smell, you know, like a when a person would smoke a pipe with that flavor.
Yeah, my dad used to smoke a pipe, yeah.
I don't have anybody in my family that ever smoked a pipe. I woke up and I thought, wow, this is so strong in my bedroom. I don't have any candles burning. I have nothing going on in the house. So I set up and I looked to see if there was smoke or something. Nothing. It dissipated about 10 minutes. But have you ever had that happen?
Nope.
I don't know what that is.
I'm about to tell you to go see a doctor. There may be something on the edge of that. I
really? Okay.
I know.
It was the freakiest thing. If you know and want to call us at 914-FOCUS-GR, and maybe we can play your what happened to me next week on the show. But
you'll get some like a neurologist calling in telling you that you're on the verge of either a brain tumor or a stroke or something. I don't think we want that.
You took Flonase and you put it in your nose and finally woke up from allergies.
All right. So besides that, well, you see ghosts too.
I have seen a ghost. Yeah. I saw one ghost in Charleston, South Carolina. That was the one ghost I did see, but so anyway. Are you asking me what caught my eye?
Yeah, I am asking you what caught your eye, yes.
So this one is an odd one for me. There was, the Philadelphia Apple Store, every day, the gentleman known as Philly Jesus stops in.
And to the Apple
Store on Walnut Store. Street okay. in Philadelphia. He stops in, and he checks his email. And but he carries this huge cross. He's got like a 10-foot cross with him. He drags it in the store. He's dressed like Jesus, good-looking guy in his 20s. His real name is Michael Grant. He's known as Philly Jesus. But he drags
Philly Jesus.
Right. So he drags this cross into the
okay. We threw it up. Thank you, John. Right,
so he
so drags Philly Jesus.
He drags this cross.
Hey, that's the art museum, right?
Yeah. He's got a little set of wheels on the bottom too for when it gets heavy. But he drags us into the Apple Store every day.
Well, Jesus didn't have wheels. Why should he? All right,
well,
anyway.
So it's heavy. Right. So they asked him to leave the store, and they said they weren't asking him to leave because he was checking his email, because he says he has an iPhone. But they said that the cross was causing a problem in the store every day. So he refused to leave. He said he had an iPhone. He said, I'm on the family plan. It's Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And so apparently how he became to be Philly Jesus is he went to Catholic school. He got kicked out his freshman year for selling weed. And then he kind of wandered around and met this woman who tried to run him over in a minivan. And it was his girlfriend. So she ran him over, and he screamed Jesus right before the minivan hit him, and she ran over his knees and his abdomen. So I'm not making it up.
All right.
Then the Philadelphia Inquirer. So he ends up taking all these, they give him all these pain meds, which leads to a heroin addiction, which we always hear about.
Mm-hmm, the opiates, yeah.
Right. So he went through a rehab program, and they say a lot of times with rehab, and this is a very long article, but a lot of times in rehab, they use the AA model, which there's a level of Christianity
So Philly Jesus must have been very aware of these steps because his dad invented them.
Right.
So technically, right? I mean, I'm
so he found Jesus in religion. They said that sometimes it's a crutch, sometimes it's used to explain things and to help you. So he decided he'd gone to clown college too in between. So he decided that
clown college? Yeah. Are you not? Philly Jesus goes to clown college.
Right.
He has an email account.
His mother thought it was a phase. She thought around Holy Week and Easter it might be done with it, but it's now going on for a number of years. He was last arrested at the Love Fountain in Philadelphia. You know where that is. He was baptizing people. All the tourists would come, and he'd baptize them in the pool, and there's pictures of them in the
Did he make any coin doing this? Was there any money?
He says he doesn't make any money, but so what happens is people will give him money. And then he will then in turn give money back to people. So if somebody gives him $15 and says, we appreciate what you're doing, and then he say an hour later someone comes up and says, do you have $5 for lunch? He'll give them the money.
$5, okay.
Because he's Jesus. And he does say Jesus does pick up, gets a lot of girls, but he needs to find one that really wants.
Jesus does.
Really loves Jesus.
I think in
good-looking guy.
Am I right that in the new parlance of the millennial, that means Jesus is thirsty? Have you heard that term?
No.
Garrett and John, probably. You know what I'm talking about, right? Is that when people say someone's thirsty?
Yeah, sure.
So the end of this story was, so they there's a picture of him being hauled out, and I could put it on our Facebook page at Focus Group Radio, but he's being hauled out of the Apple store. The problem was he couldn't get the cross in the squad car, so they had to wait for one of the vans. So if anyone knows Philadelphia, Walnut Street is a pretty big scene. It's the main shopping street in Philly, so they had to come with a police van.
Look at that.
In order to fit the cross, and a lot of the passerbys on social media were saying they were still trying to figure out how to get the cross in the back of the
Did it have the wheels that day?
I don't know if it had the wheels, but can you imagine dragging that cross into
the roller skates store? Could be good for that.
Yeah.
You could put a roller skate on the back of the cross.
That's what caught my eye this week.
What caught my eye is... decidedly different, almost mundane, and a tad boring. But I was fascinated by this because a lot of people we know, it's a big, big thing in the country, worldwide, frankly. Weight loss is a big thing on people's minds.
Yes, and it's on mine.
The fascinating thing that I read in the New York Times, there was an article about the contestants that have been on The Biggest Loser, a show that I've never really watched, but people have amazing transformations. So they profile a guy named Danny Cahill, who started out at 430 pounds and went down to 239 by the time he won the contest. I got my life back.
So he lost 200 pounds about?
It's an amazing loss. Well, fast forward, I think they talk here about a couple of years or a year and a half, and he's back up 100 and some pounds. A lot of the weight crept back on, and he's having a real difficult time keeping any of it off. And so a scientist, a guy that studies metabolism and weight, looked at The Biggest Loser and said, this is a perfect Petri dish for, looking at weight loss in the body and metabolism. So he actually looked at all the contestants, and they did some studies, and they find out that the problem with weight loss is that no matter how much you lose, the body wants to take it all back. That you're fighting your own body. So that, like, let's say you lose 100 pounds, guaranteed you're going to gain a bunch of that back in the next 6 months, and quite possibly within a year or 2 years, you'll gain 100 or more than that because your metabolism does not readjust. And so
did this guy gain the weight back?
He did. Yeah.
So somebody like you, though, because isn't a lot of it genetics? Yes. What did you weigh in college? Are you about, you know,
175?
You're about that now?
185.
So, but you are one of the lucky people that's never, whereas me, I've gained 40 pounds, lose 30, gain 4. So you've never had an issue, though, with your weight. So do you think it's genetic, or are you just a slave to it?
Their findings think that that once the body starts acquiring weight, the metabolism changes so fundamentally that you have to re-engineer your metabolism to basically do this. They even look at patients who've gone through bariatric surgery. Right. Is that the lap?
Yeah, and then they still gain weight back.
They still gain weight back as well because the body just wants it back. And then they talk about how people who are really super slim are often usually always hungry. So slimmer and hungrier. So after so 6 years after season 8 is what they used, 14 of the 16 contestants have been tested again because they did this study, and again, most of them regained all the weight. And what they're saying basically is don't beat yourself up over this, that there is a methodology for doing this. It's a metabolic set point. So we all have a set point where our bodies assume a certain amount of calories are coming in and a certain amount are going out. And it takes time to get the body to actually reset it. So a Biggest Loser contestant, how many? They do it in like 8 weeks or?
Yeah.
I don't know what the time span is, but it's not a long amount of time. And what they're claiming is that's not enough time to have your biology actually adapt to a slower, to the less caloric intake. So,
and it's retraining your eating habits, right? I mean, that's the big issue. When I did that reality show thing and lost all that weight in 8 weeks, it was a lot of it came back over probably 6 months because if you don't change your eating habits, say, I'll have a slice of pizza, I'll have two slices of pizza, you end up gaining the weight back if you're not a slave to it.
Yeah, and then what you were saying earlier about genetics, they've also keyed into a hormone called leptin, which apparently controls hunger, and when you've had a lot of weight on and you lose it, your body still produces a larger amount of this hormone that triggers the eating. So a normal weighted person who's not fluxing much, their leptin levels are all very consistent. Whereas someone who gains and then starts to lose, leptin is all over the system. And so they really are truly hungry. Their brain is telling them, you're hungry. They might not be, but I mean, physically, they might not need the calories, but they're being signaled to eat.
You're a science guy. Do you think we'll have a pill someday to get everybody back on track?
Here's what I want. I want the pill where I could dial it in and say, I want to be 180 by
180
whatever day.
Wash
whatever
more
day
abs and look like, you know, the old Jean-Claude Van Damme.
It's an interesting problem, though, because many, many people are afflicted by it, and it's causing a lot of health problems in the population in general. So that's what caught my eye. Oh. Just an interesting article. So if you're struggling with a diet, do not beat yourself up. Your body's actually not helping you, according to the research, right?
Although 430 pounds, you might want to reevaluate a few things.
Did we talk about this once before about my 600-pound life? I sometimes snap on that channel, and it's kind of like watching Hoarders Buried Alive. You know, you watch Hoarders Buried Alive, and you are like, oh, my God, I feel so good. I don't have to throw away these 5 books. I mean, you know what I mean. And Biggest Loser is the same way. You know,
no, yeah, no, listen.
600-pound, you know.
But that, my 600-pound life, who's bringing them the 15 Big Macs a day?
Well, when the last time I watched it, the woman's husband, and he brought her a burrito. Burrito and a taco, and I was like, okay.
Yeah, so there you go.
You're really helping there.
So on this day in history, John, it's May 21st, and this one's specifically for you. The bicycle was first seen in New York City.
First in New York City.
Very first. Now, do you know what the bike was originally called, the first bicycle was called?
I do, and I'm forgetting it now. It wasn't a uni?
You'll know when you hear it. Okay. Swift Walker.
A Swift Walker.
Swift Walkers, right. On this date in 1881, the American branch of the Red Cross was founded by Clara Barton. She was quite a looker, Clara Barton. Did you know Clara?
Was she really?
From the Red Cross.
Oh, there she is.
So she's quite a looker. 1881, the United States Lawn Tennis Association was also formed right here in New York.
Lawn tennis, which is just
lawn
tennis, right?
Yeah, on the grass. This one, 1929, I'd never played this game. Did you ever play the game Sorry?
Yeah.
What was it?
I don't remember Sorry that well. We had the board game.
Yeah. Well, it was patented on this day in 1929 by a Brit.
Sorry.
William Story.
Okay.
Did Sorry. In 1934, Oskaloosa, Iowa became the very first city in the U.S. to fingerprint all its residents. Nobody seemed to know why, or the citizens or whatever. It was kind of an odd one. In 1947... Joe DiMaggio and 5 New York Yankees were fined $100. I thought this was interesting if you think about the date in 1947. They were fined $100 because they didn't fulfill their contractual requirements to do promotional duties for the team. So even way back then, they were starting to do promo.
That was part of their contract, was to actually get out there.
Felt it was too commercialized. On Sunday the 22nd, Henry Kennedy received the patent for the first reclining chair. Also on May 22nd, Dr. Washington Sheffield invented the toothpaste tube.
I guess someone would have had to invent the toothpaste tube, right?
Yeah. You remember this. I wonder if you watched in 1992. This was the last day or the last airing of Johnny Carson. It was his last show, his final show after 3 years.
Yeah.
And remember
the lead up to it? I mean, every show got better and better and better to the point where everyone's like, why are you going off the air? But he left. And he never looked back.
And he was great. And I remember Bette Midler. I just remember that. She was on with him, and she did the song.
On the desk. I think she sat up on the desk.
On the desk with him and was very thankful. May 23rd, the first veterinary school in Iowa was opened. And on May 25th, a place you and I visited in 1968, the Gateway Arch was dedicated.
St. Louis
Missouri,
Arch.
St. Louis, Missouri. The business birthdays. We're the only show in the universe that does business birthdays. On this day, or on May 23rd, which would be Monday, it was the birthday for Alfred Pritchard Sloan Jr., who was a longtime president, chairman, and CEO of General Motors.
Okay.
And he pioneered the concepts of annual model change, brand architecture, industrial design, automotive design, planned obsolescence. So make sure you get rid of it so you can get another one.
So we have this guy to thank.
Yeah, and you
switching
also
our phones every year.
The big thing. He was also the first one to start an MBA program, an executive based education program at MIT way back in 1931. It was the Sloan Fellows. The one odd part about him was that there was something called the Great American Streetcar Scandal. where they felt that Sloan's leadership with General Motors removed all of the public transportation.
Notably in Los Angeles, right?
Right, and replaced it with buses and, of course, GM stock of vehicles. So it took away the, you know, rail cars and trams
public
and
transit.
Cable cars.
Yeah.
Right. And they were all fined $5,000 plus a dollar for each executive when they were found guilty in the antitrust suit. Odd one.
What year was this? In my inflation-addled brain, I'm trying to think of, is $5,000 like a lot of money?
They said it was nugatory. So it was, you know, negligible.
Okay,
it was a small amount by any standard. And then on Thursday, May 26th, it's the birthday for John Alexander Thane. Do you know him? We've talked about him before. He was the currently chairman and CEO of the CIT Group, but before then, he was the last chairman of Merrill Lynch.
For the merger with Bank of America. Ooh, the forced merger, if I'm not.
The forced merger. He was supposed to be the new executive of that newly merged company. The poor thing was only going to make up to $120 million a year. But his last year in 2007, he fell a little short, only got $83 million based upon.
$120 million.
A year. So Mr. Thane... A little bit like, who was the guy, the dandy down in Congress that redid his office? The cute one out of...
Aaron Schock. Representative
okay.
Schock. And the office ended up looking like Downton Abbey. Like these blood red walls. And...
Well, Aaron had nothing on Mr. Thane. He spent $1.2 million in 2008 to renovate the conference rooms, the reception area, and his bathroom. He spent $131,000 on rugs, $68,000 for an antique credenza, $87,000 for guest chairs, and $35,000 for a gold-plated toilet in his local private bathroom. And he had 1,100...
Everything else away. Maybe there was some value in the gold-plated toilet. You know, a good crapper.
Shit and gold.
Right? Shit and, yeah, I...
And then,
wow.
Then he had $1,100 wastebasket. Anyway, So he took a hit. He had to pay that money back. He was a supporter of low-energy Bush. Jeb Bush, he gave $200,000 this year to low-energy Bush's campaign, so we see how that happens. So, happy birthday, John. So, how
not bad.
How's
not
our
bad.
Week in science?
It was a good week in science. Well, it depends on where you live. I should rephrase that, because...
Depends where you live.
So, actually, May 21st was the day that President Carter declared Love Canal in Niagara Falls a federal, disaster area. Love Canal. It was 1980. And why, you know, you and I remember that, but it seems like a really vague thing to me. I mean, it was a huge thing.
It's still a big issue, you know. We've had him on the show, Scott McIntyre.
Yeah.
That was one of his projects out of college, and his company's
Superfund is
still working on it. They're still working
cleaning it up.
Yep.
710 families were affected. The toxic chemicals leaking through the ground of their homes caused unknown diseases, et cetera. And it's all from a company called Hooker Chemicals. Do you remember this? Hooker Chemicals? Okay. And then also on the week of May 21st, specifically May 22nd, if I say his name, I wonder if you'll know who this is. Sir Arthur Conan Doyle.
Oh, he did cards. Wasn't he a gambler?
He may have been a gambler that we don't know about, but basically he was the Scottish author and physician who created Sherlock Holmes.
Oh, got the wrong one.
Yeah, he was the author of Sherlock Holmes.
I was trying to roll back. You know, I used to work at Walden Books in high school when you would come in, and I was trying to remember if it was a card guy named Doyle.
He used to serve aboard an Arctic whaling ship as a physician, but made little money, so he turned to writing. He was a social reformer, and of course, his biggest claim to fame is the creation of famous detective Sherlock Holmes. And just because I loved Egypt, on May 27th, the archaeologist uncovered the pharaoh Cheops had it was a funereal boat. It was called the Solar Boat, and it was completely intact. And it's now on display near the Great Pyramid, actually. It's part of the Museum of Cairo. And they had never found something like it before. I mean, it's all, the oars, the whole bit. This is how they would take the pharaoh across the Nile to eventual burial. So they found that. Years later, in 1987, they found a companion boat that they had suspected existed, but...
Was that Noah's Ark?
That's some reference.
So what did Sherlock Holmes have to do with science? What did I miss there? Did I miss something?
Oh, because Sherlock Holmes was he achieved his results through deduction and reasoning.
Oh, that's a stretch.
Oh, really? Well, that's science. Science is deduction and reasoning. Yeah, that is science. Yeah, I'm sorry about that, but
okay.
You can be entitled to your own opinion, sir, but not your own facts.
That's right. Okay. Well, good.
All right. It's the focus group here with John Nash and Tim Bennett. We are going to take a quick break. And when we come back, we're going to be welcoming CEO and founder of SPI Marketing, a very good friend of ours, super cool guy, Scott Seitz. So please stay with us and we'll be right back.
The Focus Group is brought to you by Volkswagen Golf Sport Wagon. With loads of cargo space, sleek design, the versatility of an SUV, and the maneuverability of a car, the Golf Sport Wagon is in a category all its own. Learn more at VW.com.
Let's make some money.
He's the business manager. Let him manage.
This is the Focus Group.
Champagne! Champagne for everyone!
Hey, welcome back to the Focus Group. Tim Bennett here, along with my good friend and coach, John Nash. We're all business, except when we're not. Be sure to follow along with the show all week at Focus Group Radio, at all of our social media platforms, which are Facebook, Twitter, our Instagram account, which we've got to get that one moving. Yeah. And you can listen to the show at numerous platforms, but if you go to focusgroupradio.com, there's a link there so you can listen to the show, as well as find us through iTunes and TuneIn, and of course now on YouTube. You get to see our pretty faces. John and I need to decide what to wear now instead of just coming into the studio.
It's a vexing problem.
Yeah.
Because you look at Michael, I have a lot of pattern. So I'm like, uh-oh, if I wear the wrong thing, it's going to
dance.
You
would like
move.
A test pattern.
Even that one just did it a little bit now. So,
hey, as promised, we have joining us here in the focus group, Scott Seitz, who's CEO and founder of SPI Marketing. And I'll take a you two are both humble. So many people on the
we try.
There's a humble pie.
Well, I'm
going to
give you a compliment, which is rare.
Thank
so.
You.
That's a good point.
Take it while you can, right? Take it while you can.
So when I was in my life as a corporate person at Subaru of America, there were very few agencies that actually specialized in reaching the gay and lesbian consumer. And John's agency, Mulryan Nash, and then Moon City, and Scott's agency, SPI, were two of the premier agencies. And I believe, Scott, you're still probably, I don't want to say last man standing, but are you...
We're still there.
You still dedicate yourselves
20 years later. Yeah.
You still dedicate yourself to the LGBT consumer.
Wasn't there a song?
We're gay.
What Broadway song? When I'm still
I'm here.
Then I'm still here.
Postcards from the Edge.
Sondheim or something like that.
If it's Sondheim, I should know that. I'll check that out. It's all good.
So we wanted to have you come talk to us and talk to our audience about, John and I have had numerous conversations about what's going on with LGBT marketing and reaching the consumer, and thought it'd be a good discussion. For people that might not know Scott, you certainly know his work. Most famously, could I say Absolut, probably most famous?
Yeah, Absolut. And now we're doing also work with Miller Coors and a number of other clients, full-time and part-time. We've worked with Pepsi-Cola, with the CDC, et cetera. So a lot of different folks.
Cool.
Yeah.
So what...
So Tim was going to... I'll just put it to you this way. Tim and I are...
I have no warm-up on this, so let's go.
That's the way it should be. Tim and I always, like, you know, pre-plan and we're talking and... And I said, how do you want to, like, get, you know, I want to know what happened to all the gay bars. Then Scott's going to tell us what happened to all the gay bars.
They're everywhere.
Are they, or is it that we just aren't in that zone that we're going anymore?
Well, there's a couple of different things that have happened. I mean, the bar is still the bar, and anything after 11:30 is in the gay bar.
Okay,
I can't promise you.
Is that part of the problem then?
Yeah, that actually is part of the problem. And you know, it's really interesting because the market that we all started in 20 years ago was the market that was coming out of the crisis of AIDS, and they were brought together by that. I mean, in the old days, nothing brought a town together like a good public hanging. So you know, there was this thing.
It was back to Salem. If you got a witch, we got an event.
We got an event.
Yeah.
So, you know, this was that moment, and now we're moving into the first time ever. We actually have two or three or four different cultures going on inside of the gay community instead of just one. So that's a huge change. Well, I mean, you have the millennial culture or the younger culture who hasn't experienced anything like HIV and AIDS or hasn't had that same same level of drama. Matthew Shepard brought that into them for a brief moment. Yeah. But they haven't had that. They've, by and large, kind of lived a yabba-dabba-doo life, and that's great. But it also has allowed for them to be a lot more diverse in their thinking and what they're doing. And of course, I think the biggest movement is the corporate America over the last 20 years has brought safety into the workplace. And without doing that, people wouldn't have started coming out. And that's been the big thing. That's why we're seeing so many different parts of our community now. I kidded a long time ago with John and others in 96, 97, we would get phone calls in June saying, why are there so many gays now? And we're like, no. They were always here.
Because they're all in a boat.
If you were in Chicago, they were at Halstead or in Lincoln Park. But in this case,
the gays are on a big boat. Yeah. It sails around. It's Magellan. It's like Magellan. You sail around and it pulls in June and it pulls out again later on. You'll see
Pride Leprechaun, John.
Exactly.
The Pride. Yeah, the Pride ship.
But I...
So that's just set up. I didn't answer.
No, but I would just but I would disagree a little bit in that. I think the last recession, 2009, I think we saw an awful lot of corporations that had the consumer facing programs to the gay community or gay, lesbian, LGBT, however you want to phrase it, go away, and agencies go away, and the marketing go away. We'll just throw it to our general agency; they can handle it. I know a lot of companies did the same thing with African American marketing, Hispanic marketing, Asian marketing, marketing to women. A lot of those agencies that specialize in those niche markets all seem to have dried, gone away. I will say what you mentioned: there's a lot of these employee resource groups, but I've had an issue with them. I don't want to speak for John. I think John does too, but he can chime in. Is that while those are nice, I don't know if that just says, okay, we've got an employee resource group. The gays get together once a month in the cafeteria. We did a little fundraiser and we'll move on.
Come on, how much for crepe paper?
Yeah. You know,
can you cut that budget down to 450?
Because we've been asked, we were asked by two major, I would say major Fortune 50 companies to go speak.
Right.
And when we said, here's what our message was going to be about letting the consumer know that you're LGBT friendly, brakes went right on. No, we want you to stay within this wheelhouse of talking to our employee resource group. Well, then you're done. What's the point at that?
No, and I think that that's very valid. I think I'll go back to say that workforce equality has really led the way in a lot of ways. I will continue to point out that there's a whole world of LGBTQIA people or gay people, but that's not represented 100% by New York, LA, and Chicago. So I think we need to really be focused on all those sorts of things. I think what's happened is that safety has come in. The groups have formed. They're still trying to figure out how to really be effective. And marketing is changing. Marketing in the past, in 20 years ago and in the 90s and in the heady part of the 90s and early 2000s, you know, they had enough fluff money to throw it at an ERG or to throw it at a corporate foundation and all these sorts of things. And more and more and more and more since 2008 and going forward, I think that the challenge is always going to be make your stockholder happy. You got to complete your ROI. Yeah, and if you're doing that, you can't, the fluff part starts going away. So I think one of the founding principles of what we've been doing has been always focusing in on the ROI. And the lucky part of being in the beverage business with gay bars is we can measure it. You know, the first people to realize who the gays were the ones calling on the bars, and that's not entirely true, but that's a great example.
When Scott and I, our agencies partnered for a number of years on some wonderful work, and when Scott actually laid out the fact that you had metrics, and it was case sales. So any Chicago, like the sidetracks still there, right?
Yeah. Love sidetracks.
So sidetracks could they knew from the amount of cases going in there what their volume was. So you could actually go back to one of your clients and say, you spend this, we go in there because you do a lot of sampling and event nights. You're going to sell this many cases. Not the same with a lot of the accounts that.
So in the virtual world, so famously you worked on. We're talking with Scott Seitz from SPI Marketing, who I would say, from my point of view, famously did a lot of work with Absolut to make it the vodka for the gay community. What's happened to Absolut though? I don't seem to see them anymore. Are they still? Are you doing work with them still?
Well, it's sort of like, you know, why are there so many gays now? You know, it's more like, so why are there so many, no, why are there so many craft vodkas now?
their challenges as a brand go well beyond who their core audiences were, because now you've got everybody competing to be the vodka, right?
Because you used to have the back page of every Advocate, for instance, and a number of the national publications. But have they moved away into digital? And
mostly moving into digital. And a lot of companies right now, again, as they're struggling themselves with figuring out how to talk to multicultural, this isn't exclusive to the gay community. This is completely a multicultural crisis as well, because as you mentioned, they've figured out a way to move Hispanic and African-American marketing over to their general marketing agency, which is sort of like, I don't want to deal with my government right now, so I'm going to, with my state government right now, so I'm going to let the head of North Carolina take care of what's right for us, and we'll trust it. It's like, it really kind of doesn't make sense. At some point, you've opened up the barn doors for a lot of other stuff. And, you know, what we advocate and what we work at very hard is creating a very genuine, organic relationship with the community. And that can go away if you've got somebody who's really, you know, on top of that, the metrics for anything multicultural are far more difficult to get. So you have a couple of leaders like Hear Media in the gay community and some of the online, you know, gay cities and edge media where you have opportunities to have metrics. But everything else sort of isn't really tracked. So your media companies aren't necessarily going to give you the real facts or the best facts possible.
Well, that's not in their interest.
Yeah.
I'm totally fascinated
by the fact that they often come up with, we have a panel of 7,000 people, and I'm like, that's curious. Yeah. I've never heard of that panel. And some people have the money to have those kinds of panels, but a lot of them are
panel, you know.
Yeah. Well, I just keep noticing
this
at the bottom
you're
of the
be
page.
Latino.
Yeah,
this week you're going to
you
be a lady
called on this panel. So years ago, you and I used to prep for presentations to get the following question. You know, like to actually navigate the gay question. Mm. With well-intentioned non-gay executives, you know, why are we doing this? Is there going to be a you know,
and touching? Will they touch?
You know, here's an example. Scott and I worked on one of my favorite ads. Was an Absolut ad, and it was from a wonderful. Tim was the brand.
Tim Murphy.
Tim Murphy was the head of, like, the CMO at the time.
Yep. Or he was president.
President, and he did this. They were trying to restart the brand. They did this whole thing called In an Absolut World. I think we talked about this on an earlier show, where we all brainstormed in that idea of the ruler with 888. But I remember being at Absolut's headquarters down on Park Avenue South when some of the women in the room were like, are you sure this is not going to offend people? Like, I had not prepared for this because it's just a ruler. And then Scott actually had to come up and say, no, here's my position, here's how the consumers. So is that dialogue's changed now?
She was offended because she wanted it. They've been told it was 12.
Measurement has always been an issue.
That's always been, it's always been an issue.
But
I'm offended, it's only 8.
But has that dialogue changed? And are you dealing with that? Or do you have to resell the consumer, meaning the LGBT consumer, to corporate America?
Sure.
And are you is that the you know, grab the hill every year routine?
It's really a grab the hill, not always for the reasons you're thinking about. The other part of it is, in corporate America, you know, we're here. In corporate America, you got a 9-month lifespan, or maybe if you're lucky, a 15-month lifespan on your brand manager or somebody like that.
That's true.
When I read the
trades, it's like, you know.
The average CMO lasts, 18 months. If they last 18 months, they're doing pretty good.
Yeah. Really? Okay.
Yeah, and my favorite game is, you know, I'm not making the numbers, lay off a ton of people in November, making the numbers, start hiring in January, you know. So everybody starts planning for that now, which is unfortunate. Okay. And that's a comment outside of what we do. But
so you've reintroduced yourself. How many teams, like, take any of your clients, what's an average number of times you've had to reintroduce yourself to management?
I go to Ground Zero every 13 months.
Think about that for a minute.
minimum.
Now, you know,
and I think that's the millennial mindset too, by the way. I'll just draw that back. I think we're hitting a reset button maybe every
actually you did 9 to 13
months with the millennial consumer. And I think it's important, especially as a small consultancy, you know, it's important for us to sort of hit the reset button ourselves each year when we're putting together a plan for the client to really reevaluate it and not just take an
so
easy
So what do you mean when you say hit the reset button? Like, would you know what we're talking about when you hit the reset every 9 or 13?
Yeah.
Apparently,
what's your takeaway on that?
No, the takeaway is, like anything, is reevaluating where you are and what the messaging is, how it's changed. If you think of just what we've done, as Scott mentioned, and what we did at Subaru and Absolut 10 years, 15, 20 years ago, you wouldn't even consider doing now. Let's do the regional books. Let's go to gay pride events. Now, I don't know if people are still doing that sort of thing, but so I think now you're reevaluating how do you reach new markets. But I struggle with the millennial thing because I don't know how that the millennial market is all that much different than any generation.
I think they're just distracted.
But
more.
Then any generation mm-hmm. saying there are certain commonalities, I'm sure, but. They're very different than the generation before that, but so were we.
Yeah.
Right?
And
we were latchkey kids or...
Mm-hmm. I think there's a lot more in common than there isn't, but I also think that, the millennial... What we also have learned through some of the research that we've done is the millennial really wants to... This is a millennial that isn't trying to be a part of the larger gay community as it was when we were growing up and we had mentors and everything else. We have we have a lot of people right now who are, they're hanging out with their straight friends. They start pre-gaming at 6 o'clock. One of the things that shocked our clients is going through what they actually do and how much they actually drink and how much mixing they actually do in the night. And they, you know, starting out with a little pre-gaming at somebody's
mixing
apartment.
as in they're breaking my cardinal rule.
Beer, wine, vodka,
never
whiskey.
Mix, never worry, folks.
hit a weed.
You start with vodka, you stay with the potato.
Okay, 21-year-olds are different.
Start with gin.
You're rigid.
Stay with the juniper berry.
You know when you were young, you drank what was there.
You know what they
said. You had them, smoke them.
And you know, and actually, yes, and my favorite events with drinking were when someone would give me punch at a party, and everybody, all the upper class would be like,
grain alcohol.
It was grain. You'd be flying, and then wham. So then I'm not advocating, I'm not saying they're doing grain, but you mean they're literally, from your perspective, you could have three brands in the spirits category. It could be beer and wine, it could be alcohol, it could be cordials or something. That same person might go through all different things in one night, right?
Yeah, especially at our house. So it's not an issue at all. What you're going to find is they're going to go and they're going to do their little pre-partying, and that's going to probably be some combination of vodka and beer. And beer can be a pacer for folks. Beer or wine could be a pacer. It's sort of a pacer. So
you want to
kick it in quick, and then you want to kind of float a while, and then they take this.
You're
out of it, Nash.
And on set with
Grandpa.
Two alcoholics?
Grandpa Nash, you're out of it.
It's important to know, though, because if you're trying to talk to him, you got to figure out where it's relevant and how you're doing it.
But this goes back to what
it's
we opened.
It's pretty Kentucky Derby sound.
Right, but yes. Exactly.
And they're at the gate.
But it goes back to what we said earlier, though, about the bars. Yeah. So if I'm a gay or lesbian person hanging around with all my straight friends, what has happened to our tribe, I guess, for lack of a better word? Mm-hmm. Because... We all hung around with straight friends too, but there was also something different about going to a gay bar or hanging out with older gay people or being a sense of community. So is that all missing?
It's not missing. It's changed. I think one of the things that the bars saw early on was that all of a sudden the straight bars that were trying to get more business on a Wednesday night were bringing in a promoter for the women's community or whatever to be a gay night. So all of a sudden what's been going on is actually, for me, the metric that I can measure is the gay bar. So now our metrics are getting a little messed up because people are really drinking in three or four different venues in an evening. They start out
specific to their
right, and they're starting out with, and they're creating their own niche. I mean, that's the difference. Is instead of feeling like I want to be a part of this larger group, they're sort of they want to. Dr. David Gudelunis, who did a lot of our research, sort of phases it as they kind of want to.
I like
not
the fact that you call him Dr. David.
Dr. David.
I don't. Does he care?
I never knew Doctor
was.
March
around with that doctor title. I mean, it's
not often, but I do like that.
It's okay. You could play the doctor. Dr. David Gudelunis.
He does it when he's on Huffington Post and that sort of thing.
Yeah, right. I was going to say.
But, you know, the fun thing is his comment is they want to be everywhere you're not, because they're trying to create their own tribe right now. So that's not about, like, they're running away from the older gay community or LGBTQIA community. It's that they're trying to have their own piece of it. And sometimes you have places like Julius's with the resurgence now and with her historical landmark status and everything else.
Julius is like the oldest gay bar in the city.
And it's
I thought the Stonewall was, no?
No, Julius is around the corner, and it's a classic, man. It's a classic.
Yeah. Our oldest bar in Philly just closed.
What was that? Woody's or
Venture In?
Venture In.
We'll talk about that. But anyway, I think that
hand gesture meant that there's something financial.
Well, what? I love going
it's
there.
It's answering. It is your question. Really, is it's changing. But the point I want to make is that they do end up in a gay bar because they start out the evening with their friends, which has changed. So you're now having straight and gay people going into straight bars and gay bars and dive bars and this, but then they evolve to the straight people go home and go to bed, and the gay men and women are going out to a bar.
So let's get right to the chase center. Are people still picking up at the bars?
Yes.
Okay. As long as that's happening.
Well, from what,
last time, John,
from what
I
can tell.
I'm so glad to hear that.
John and I had done an event in Las Vegas, and we had gone out there, and so I don't think either of us had been to a gay bar in years. We were shocked at watching everybody bumping into each other on their phones, walking
and
around on
I'm
their
sure
phones and hitting each
I'm
other.
I'm sure the only app that was up there was Grindr or Scruff or name your take your app.
So that was shocking to us because
I
thought, oh my
a
God,
look with people but
and good looking people and you know we thought man
just update your profile. Okay. Yeah. I think, but you know, that's a really interesting point though. The point that I'd make is that there is actually an argument that you could develop around social media and Grindr and Growler and Scruff driving people to the bars, because it's not just about I'm 200 feet away, knock on the door and, mm-hmm. and you know, come on in. It's also about I want to see you, I want to make sure you're normal, you're this. So it's kind of becoming a social thing to meet up a little bit as well. So
Scruff could have an event with the local bar and get people
have
there. Yeah.
Powered by Scruff, or you have Growler events and you have Grindr events. And
actually,
and
it's perfect for there's a whole bunch of guys I know that would really prefer, they might be on the social apps, but they would prefer to meet someone, just say hello, a drink, a cup of coffee before you know, they're often SOL, shit out of luck, because the minute you say I want to meet you, apparently that's click or swipe, you're not on my list, but
I think
that would serve that purpose.
I think it's odd to just have someone show up at your house sometimes. But
it's. I think people are finding it
that's
more and more risky.
And that's an age thing. I think when you're in your 20s, I don't think you
think
about
that
risk
way.
Like that. I think when you're in your 30s or 40s, you think, wait a minute.
Ding dong!
And someone's dragging an axe with blood dripping off it. You're like, are you? No.
Right. Is your father's picture?
not necessarily a non sequitur, but a different line of questioning. As we've said all along, we're talking to Scott Seitz, who's the CEO and founder of SPI Marketing, one of the premier and longest running LGBT marketing specific agencies in the country, maybe the world.
Maybe the only one left.
There are a few popping up. And yeah, it's all good.
As we talk about the community and about the changes it's gone through, just for my, you know, I go through this a lot too. How often have you had to reinvent yourself, and does the industry still excite you, and are there things that still surprise you and keep you going to work every day?
Oh, I think that's like the most important question that you could ever ask.
Thank you. I'm glad to have asked it.
Oh, show's over. Tune in next week. You get the answer.
You know, I think that, well, fundamentally, we're in that headspace. Yeah. We're fundamentally in that headspace where we started SBI, and we continue to want to grow it because we're creating transactions and interactions, and that's still happening, and it's still a lot of fun, and we're seeing changes in edits. So, you know, we're seeing opportunities now to build at a B2B level. We're seeing, so it is staying fresh. It is staying different. We are kind of growing our brain around other areas. And I think, you know, one of them is finding new ways in metrics, because, you know, if you take a look at the liquor industry, yes, you can show that the gay consumers are indexing 3 and 4 times the general population. So and what I really love is the gay bars index like 10 to 15 times more than a general market bar. So if you take a gay bar that's got a capacity of 240 people and you look at the general market bar next, you know, you're going to see 3 to 4 times the volume happening inside of that gay bar in that same space as in a general market bar. So there's a lot of, you know, for me, metrics are a new space to open up, because one of the things we'll continue to do is build visibility for the community. So the important thing is when we have a client that starts seeing how this community spends and does and acts, and they become valuable to this community. So, you know, our goal would be to see a lot of these people that do a new gay ad every 2 years that they get a lot of credibility for, but then there's really no follow-up from that, you know, which is a great thing, and it's a great first step. But if they can't measure it, they don't necessarily know what to do afterwards either. So that's a big thing.
Business still invigorates you. I mean, earlier you were talking about, like, you're at ground zero every 9 to 13 months.
Yeah, I didn't say that part invigorated me. But
well, all right, so that part is what actually kind of ground me down in the dust after a while, because you and I came up through a system where the relationship mattered. You know, you would know a director of marketing or something who was at that company for 8, 10, 12 years. Mm. There was a history of the two brands working together. And now, you know, I know you've, I remember once I went to visit you and you were preparing the binder. It was this thing for going over, it was actually after Absolut was acquired by the good folks at Pernod Ricard. It was a lot of the staff are the same, but everything had to be justified again. And Scott had statistics and metrics and case sales, and you swam through it. But I don't even know how long it took you to pull that all together. So my thing is, if it's every year you're literally doing that, you have to have a really good stomach for it, I guess, right?
Well, I think, you know, well, we definitely have presentations that we can pull out of the box a little bit now, too. So that certainly helps.
True.
And, you know, yeah, we do what we call Gay 101 a lot, and less often, maybe because people are a little more connected with the community and they sort of get it, but they don't necessarily, you know, what we really try and do is educate them on, this is a real consumer and here are some real metrics. Because, you know, this isn't about, you know, we knew long ago when we started this business, and I came out of sales and marketing with Kodak and then later marketing and operations at Pepsi.
Was that Polaroid?
I know. And my niece
is
married.
That KTEL Records. I sold Peugeots, Yugos.
Every dead brand.
And I had a
Memorex.
We had a Pabst Blue Ribbon store. That's back.
That's a big one.
You remember TDK and Memorex?
Yeah. Oh my God.
Cassette tapes. I lived in tracks. Like a cassette
and my dad called them K-sets, which almost put me in an early grave. I could not.
K-sets.
Scott, grab that K-set off the shelf for your father.
I just didn't know what to do. That, and we were from Michigan, and so, you know, it was Italian. And
Italian.
Like,
well, that's right. That's still correct.
You going to Italy or what?
Was it Arabs too? The Arabs.
Arabs.
Italy.
I'm like, oh,
quick one before we let you go. I know we're on the clock. Has the visibility of trans affected your business at all or not?
Well, it has in a really good way, I think. It's a part of the conversation before. I mean, you know, our clients would often, especially new people, are like, we want to be cutting edge. And I always like to say cutting edge as long as you're using a wooden spoon. Right. You know, it's not...
cutting edge, not bleeding edge. Right? Yeah,
well, yeah, I mean, we're not doing some of those other things. But the fact that it's actually, you know, and this is stuff that John and I used to talk about and later we talked about as well. It's just moving so much quicker for this community than other things. So I think it's fantastic that transgender is there. I'm seeing clients who are interested and unafraid of thinking about it or talking about it or being a part of it. And that's really good because years ago they were like, you know,
well, the B and the T was off the table.
The B and the T is off the table. Well, and it's really, and it's also like, how do I talk to them and what do I say? And
right.
We've been in meetings.
Where how people, do I measure it?
We've been in meetings where people ask us like about bears.
Oh yeah.
I mean, like, well, you got your American, you got your, you know, you could go through the but they were asking and John, what's a cub?
What's a cub? And well, someone called right. and said we're missing a mark and an opportunity with the otter.
And someone says, what's an otter?
With the otter, we're missing an opportunity with the otter.
Otters. We're missing man called the otters. Yeah,
and we'd get those calls. Hey. It was tough enough to sell gay and lesbian. And then when somebody would call in and say, you're really missing an opportunity
remember,
with the bears.
There was a magazine called Bear's Life.
Sure, Steve-O.
Oh, Steve-O wanted me to present to Subaru. And oh, believe me. I
sent the magazines in to the president and the CFO and everybody.
Yep. So eventually Tim calls me up one day and says, you know, you're going to have to let him come down or you're going to have to shut this off because we're getting inundated by bears. and he goes, I got guys coming in saying, hey, Tim, what's an otter? It's a cub, you know, like, and what,
well, the magazines were going in the free bin that we had it. That's because we get that's magazines awesome. For everything. So people that's are like, awesome. Oh, bears.
The free bin, right?
I'm looking, where are the bears?
You know, I see this guy wearing it. So I had him in one day and I said, okay, we're going to go to the magazine now. We're going to play a game. It's called Where Does the $32,000 Car Go? And so we start flipping the pages, and here's an ad for dildos, and here's something else.
A harness, and lube.
A harness, and actually, by the time we got to the end of the book, he was very kind of crestfallen, and he said, I think I see where you're going. I said, and where am I going? And I said, that product does not belong. Well, bears got to go. They drive. I'm like, I know they do. And they take care of their young.
It was the same issue. It was the same issue with Penthouse and Playboy. They would come in all the time
hard.
And sell
it's
as
hard.
Well.
Yeah.
And, you know, as long as you moved yourself away from the skin far enough.
Yeah, you'd be
and
fine.
From editorial that wasn't perhaps.
Those books had the editorial well they could do that with, though, right?
Yes
they
and
had,
no.
Oh, really?
It was tough. You know, right. Next thing well, you know, yeah. There's a picture of the car, then ba-boom, there she is.
Yeah. It's a tough magazine now, yeah. Too. So,
Ram yeah, tough.
You know, it's interesting, though, because I think one of the interesting differences is the bear community. The bear community. What I found interesting from a number of articles, a recent one, I think it was Forrester Research had done an app study. And when you look at the different apps like Grindr and Growler and Scruff and everything else, you can see that actually there's a bigger appeal and a more consistent market inside of the bear community
yep.
than
oh, yeah.
inside of
yep.
the bear community.
They spend money and they're established.
And loyal.
Very, very
and
much.
And our favorite stories from P-Town are like, they really, 4th of July, the restaurants were starving because nobody ate. They were all drinking water. And then the next week was bear week and they had food and they...
Who's they were all drinking water?
And,
the party boys. Well,
so it was
they didn't need food.
It's an interesting group and it's fun that we even get to think about that. And with a beer client, we certainly
yeah.
do. So,
well.
All right, we are going to have you back in a couple weeks, I think, because you want
to
yeah. talk about an initiative that is very close to your heart called .gay. People can actually visit .gay online, right?
Yep.
And learn about
we're
the
actually
initiative.
Redoing the site, but go anyway, and it'll probably be back.
Oh, actually, yes, it will be because I know how this how we air our episodes. But I do invite you to visit .gay. It's .gay.com, right?
Yeah, dotgay.com.
And learn about Scott's initiative. It's been a 6-year effort. And there's some interesting stuff coming along there. So CEO and founder of SPI Marketing, SPI.com?
SPIMarketing.com.
Yep. Scott Seitz, thank you for joining us. John Nash with Tim Bennett. We're going to take a quick break. When we return, more Focus Group.
Thanks.
The Focus Group with Tim Bennett and John Nash is brought to you by Volkswagen and their full line of fun to drive vehicles. Visit VW.com to learn more.
That was a stunning Focus Group.
Focus on the savvy side of 9 to 5 with the Focus Group.
Been in business a week. I got more money and I know what to do with.
Listen, laugh, and learn with Tim and John.
Herrera Rocher. He is doing well.
Hey, welcome back to the Focus Group. Tim Bennett here, as always, with my good friend and co-host, John Nash. We are the Focus Group, where we're all business, except when we're not.
We're getting our money's worth out of that tagline.
No, that was your, we're all business, except when we're not. But be sure to find us everywhere. Follow along with us. Best thing to do is go to focusgroupradio.com. Be sure to let your friends know about us. And now we have this new
venue as well. You not only have to listen to us or can listen to us, but you can look at us as well. So over at our YouTube channel.
That could leave you running for the hills, or you could want to...
And our new shows come out every Saturday morning. So if you're used to us on our old platform for the last 8 years, you can still listen to us on Saturdays. Our shows will be up there and available for you to download or to listen to. So we're doing our Shop Talk segment now. And John had found an article that the headline was intriguing. It said, instead of hiring three people, I sent the IRS $170,000. And essentially, as I read this, it was quite an in-depth article, but it was a business owner who's an entrepreneur, and he's talking about his tax burden and about how there's this, particularly with the election going on now, there's an awful lot of talk.
Tax the rich.
About the rich not paying their fair share. And he says, in fact, yes, I do pay my fair share, and I probably pay over 50% more. And there was an issue, and I laughed when you sent this, because I know a number of small agencies in Philadelphia that left Philadelphia for this very reason. But the reason he had this tax burden was because, aside from the payroll taxes and state taxes, all those other taxes that he did not include in this number, he had to pay on an inventory of product. So they bought product for a customer.
And it's held inventory, right?
It was held inventory that was going to be sold, but the government viewed it as an asset. So they were taxed on it. And this has happened, and it happens in Philadelphia, probably happens in a lot of other cities for small agencies. If you're an agency and you have, say someone says to you, buy $50,000 worth of media, the agency doesn't see that money, but the government looks at that as income.
Yeah, because even it's though you're through.
Even though you're taking it and passing through, and you might keep 5% or 10%, whatever your agreement is with your media partner. So he talked about how they need to get off of this this kick that the rich aren't paying taxes, and he gives a number of examples, and I thought it was fascinating. I don't know.
Well, what one paragraph that I loved was when he was discussing this held inventory issue. As a result, we drained the bank account to pay off the inventory. So they paid off everything. So they owned it outright. They're going to resell it. And then we were hit with a larger than expected tax bill. In other words, the business was fully invested in inventory and people, a healthy business. And then we had to pay tax on money that was not yet earned. And this is the thing that I love about how this all comes down.
You and I, how often have we dished out money?
Quarterly payments. Here in New York City, there's something called the UBT, the unincorporated business tax. So New York figures that, and Philly does the same thing, I think, right? So they figure, there's the corporations,
and then there's
sole proprietors and there's small businesses, but they're unincorporated, but they should be taxed as well.
And we don't get to collect unemployment.
Nope.
You lose a client. He says, and he goes to correct, because he had posted something that went viral on YouTube, and he said, I'm not opposed to government spending. I'm not arguing that I don't want to pay my fair share. He says, but what is my fair share? He said, is it 45? He said 45%. I thought this number was staggering. He said, instead of me hiring three people, he obviously had to pay the government. But he said, meanwhile, 45% of the country pays no taxes at all. And you're telling me that the $170,000 I paid, what is my fair share?
Well, when that piece went viral that you're talking about, people would accuse him online of being a spoiled, white, privileged brat.
Yeah.
Who should be thankful for the roads, highways, and opportunities that have allowed my business to grow. Now, can I just pause on the roads and highways part? I'm not entirely thankful for our roads and highways because they're falling apart. So don't give me this bullshit that all our tax dollars are going to this magnificent kind of utopian infrastructure, because it's not, right?
No, it's not Shanghai. Mm-mm. It's why Donald Trump, whether you're a fan, and everybody knows where we stand on Donald Trump, but it's why he resonates with people.
If he comes on the show, I'll change my stand.
He talks about how our airports are third world, the trains we take are the wild, wild west when they run on time. Our whole infrastructure in this country is a mess. And he said, and the author says, I don't mind paying my fair share, but I also want to make sure that, yes, the government does spend the money wisely and not going to needless wars and some of these other things. When he mentioned the part of this about the infrastructure that he mentioned reminds me, and I fight this all the time. I don't know if I'm beating a dead horse, but when you buy a car, you pay taxes on it, right? Mm-hmm. So you pay tax for having a car.
You pay tax to get a license.
So shouldn't all these taxes, gasoline, registration,
developed your to license, pay for the highway fund?
No, we're paying tolls. Yep. Then if you sold your car to me,
I've got to pay tax on it. Yeah. If I sell it, it's taxed again. If the $25,000 car has already been taxed, why is it being taxed three more times when it's being sold? My parents in Connecticut have to pay, I didn't realize this until I was up there last time, cars are considered property and it's a property tax. So the town of Southbury taxes my parents
close
to $600 for the two cars each year. I said, for what? You already paid tax on it when you bought it.
Can you think about sitting down with city council? Guys, we got to raise more money.
I think a car is property.
Maybe since that car is parked in the driveway, that's property. I mean, it's...
The tax burden. I have a friend on Facebook who's a entrepreneur and a businessman similar to this guy Ryan, who wrote this piece that
Ryan Moran,
and he says the same thing. He said, you know, I don't mind paying my fair share, and he has a small business. He employs 8-10 people. He said, but by time at the end of the day, he said, I go without. This happened to you with your agency. There were times where it was lean when a client's late paying or something. You and I have it with our business that we will do without to make sure that people get paid or make sure that your bills are paid.
You better have money in the bank, right?
And you got to pay this government nut every quarter, which is a year ahead, which is crazy. Because that's not guaranteed revenue. You're not guaranteed that revenue is coming in. A client could say, we're done.
So here's
this guy bought all that inventory.
Here's the game the U.S. government plays with payroll. So you work for a company and you're paying taxes every paycheck, the payroll tax, right? So the payroll tax was invented to collect the money early because technically you're not supposed to be paying tax until you have a sense of what you've earned. So end of the year, let's say you make $25,000 or $50,000. Okay, now the government gets this. But the payroll tax is a way to start that process early, get the money into the pipeline. Tim and I were on the phone with our accountant around tax time.
Ugh.
And when you own a small business, you could pay your taxes in quarterly installments. And this is my part I love. And I've never not made a quarterly payment. And I've always been fearful of what those penalties would be. So Tim actually asked our accountant. He says, hey, Jack, we're going through a transitional period. We would rather have the cash on hand to deal with paying people and doing the stuff of doing business. The tax money can wait. Oh, I wouldn't advise that. I would not advise that.
No.
And we're like, well, what's the penalty then? Well, if you don't, oh, the penalty is pretty high. It could be as high as $85 or $90. So I'm on the phone like, really? Because in New York City, that's a lunch for two at a nice restaurant.
It's a lunch for us. After the show.
I think I'm not going to pay, and I'm going to hold on to it. And
hold on to that $8,000 for that quarter that we owe the government, and we'll take the $90 penalty.
But I think that this is one of the frustrations of owning a business. You and I would much rather have had Ryan, who wrote this article, employ three more people.
Right.
Because that's three more jobs, and that's something that will allow his business to grow and ultimately pay more taxes, right? On goods sold, on whatever it could be.
Well, that's why I thought I like the article, because I think it brings home a big issue that needs to be talked about, and I do think that the wealthy do now. Corporations, we know, get tax breaks. You stay in a city, but you get a tax break or tax deduction. But I think a small business owner they pay their fair share, otherwise they're locked up. So
add in healthcare and everything else, food, lodging. Oh my God!
It's a good article, John.
Stop the planet. I want to get out. No. No, I like the planet. It's fine. All right. It's the focus group with John Nash and Tim Bennett. We're going to take a really quick break and come back. Are we doing Ask Tim and
ask
John?
Ask Tim and John. Do you have an ask for me?
Do I have an ask for you? I might, yeah. Okay. It's been a bad, it's been a crazy week. All right. Stay with us. We'll be right back after this break.
The Focus Group is brought to you by the newly redesigned Volkswagen Passat. It's time to give your family a serious upgrade. Visit VW.com to learn more.
It's time for Ask Tim and John. Call 914-FOCUS-GR and ask Tim and John anything you want. If your question gets selected and used on air, you'll be sporting a pair of the famous Focus Group socks. Oh, and to make it a little fun, Tim and John will have no idea what question will be thrown at them. So be nice. Again, that number is 914-FOCUS-GR. 914-362-8747.
John, I'm wondering if I should dye my hair. Is it gray?
Just for men.
Just for Men.
You could comb it in.
We need a sponsor, Just for Men. Sorry.
I can't even do that. Just for Men, you have to comb it in. What am I going to comb in? I could paint it in, I guess. You know, I remember years ago there was a guy that we used to see. He used to spray this stuff on the. It was like some.
Oh yeah, like that stuff, like plaster Paris.
I don't know. It was some kind of.
Yeah, foamy.
Almost like silly string, or, and if you saw.
Tom Popeil sold that.
Yeah, it was from the right angle. It was like, oh my God, what is that? And you could imagine taking a shower, that stuff coming off.
My mother got it from my dad until he went to until he went to bed and stained all the pillowcases
the fine
and
linen.
The garbage. So do you have a?
I have a question because a question that I sometimes get asked myself by people who come for an informational interview or they're seeking some mentor mentee advice. Can you think of one business interaction that you would love to go back and change? It could be a conversation. It could be a decision you made. Then you walked. Even while you were making it, you're like, oh boy, no, that was not the right.
One business interaction.
It's just a
second chance at a business
kind
interaction.
Of thing. Yeah, it's a job you should have taken. It's wasn't a right fit, square peg, round hole kind of thing.
Ah, boy. You know, there's a couple of them, I think, but...
If there's a couple, just pick one of your...
Yeah, no, I would say there was there was an interaction where I guess I didn't stick up for myself the way I think I should have. So there was a TV commercial that was being produced. And
I know the story.
It's a real. Yeah. It was micromanaged from New Jersey, I was in Los Angeles, and thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars, and I could see where the thing was going south. So I called the CMO at the time, the chief marketing officer. Oh, just let the agency do their job. Don't worry about it. It's all been approved. Well, it was a shit show when it came back. The commercial was bad. I knew it was bad. We all knew it was bad.
That commercial ranks as one of the
worst
that
brand
ever produced.
Yeah. So it gets shown, and then everyone in the room had amnesia, and they all pointed to me, and I said, do you remember me calling you on Sunday to get you out of church to ask you and tell you that this thing was going south?
To get you out of church?
Yeah, I called him and he turns red because he was such a little snake. He turned red and like, oh, I don't remember. He totally hands off. And I should have got ahead of it instead of showing it right there. So if I had a chance to do that again, I would have opened up the meeting with, here was the sequence of events. Here's how we got to where I'm going to show you right now. Because the commercial came on and everybody was like, oh my gosh. And I said, yeah.
It was dark. It literally was like not the brand.
And the other thing was the guy, it was around a terrorist attack that we had had. And the guy looked, the whole thing was a mess. So the music was wrong. Everything was wrong. And the agency didn't take responsibility for it. The senior management didn't.
That bunch didn't take responsibility for much.
No.
Unless it was something good. Oh, look, we did.
And that's why they're handling minnows and lottery right now. But other than that...
that's the same bunch that used to charge you per color copy.
Per color copy.
On a visit.
How come these aren't color copies? Well, those cost money. I know.
Bury it.
But, you know, show it to me somewhere. And don't tell me you need a limo from Connecticut to take you to the airport. That's not what I want to see.
I want to see...
I don't care seeing a line item for color copies.
Transportation. Yeah.
Idiots. But, so I would say that would be one where I probably should have...
been more.
I should have up front said, hey, here's what you're going to see, and here's how we got to where we are today. And it would have cut off all the BS of, well, what happened here. So that was probably one
more
interaction.
Of a spine.
Yeah. I'll have to think
you have
about
a good
this.
One.
That's a tough one. That's
oh, yeah.
Have you had some where you put your foot in your mouth?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. You've been with me when I've done it, just in social things.
That's why I think this wine thing out in the vineyard would be good for us to be together.
Oh,
because
yeah.
we get you lubed up a little bit on some Chardonnay and get you...
Alcohol has a way of making strange bedfellows of people, and strange things come out of our mouths sometimes when we start talking with the...
Well, that's a good question, John.
All right, folks. It's been the Focus Group. We want to thank all our partners and sponsors, especially Volkswagen of America, who's been with us for almost 7 years now. Check out Passat, check out the Jetta, and most importantly, coming up is going to be a new car that we're very excited about called the Golf Sportwagon All-Track.
Just call it the All-Track.
It's the All-Track. Thank you. It's the All-Track. And what does that mean? It's all-wheel drive. And Tim and I have basically been dealing with all-wheel drive all our careers, and we love it. And I think it's a great thing to have in their lineup.
So tune into the focus group next week, and stay happy and healthy. And remember, it's focusgroupradio.com, YouTube, iTunes, and anywhere where fine podcasts are sold and traded.
Join the Focus Group on all forms of social media. It's easy. And like good marketers, our branding is uniform across all platforms. Find us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Periscope at Focus Group Radio. Again, join the conversation across all of our social media platforms at Focus Group Radio.